just to say this is the first sustainability summit, hopefully of many, that the Royal College is hosting. And we're engaging today as a group with all of the myriad challenges that face psychiatry. And the first question really is just for you to sort of reflect a bit on what Daniel said and what you think the main challenges are for the future of psychiatry in terms of sustainability, obviously the economic side, the social, and the environmental, that triple bottom line.
Oh, fantastic. Wonderful.
Easy good. Question.
Yes.
About 30 seconds.
Oh, that's fine, yeah. I guess, though, in terms of the subject matter of this conference, I mean, there's two things that come to mind. One is just listening to Daniel already talking about the power of technology in reducing costs and reducing our carbon footprint. I think that's all very well, but I think the real challenge, I mean, we can do that, and I'm sure we are. I'm involved in several initiatives for veterans using internet as opposed to face-to-face and things like that. I think the challenge will be how you make that work in such a way that you also capture the essential skills of psychiatry, which is about human contact. And I think there is a big trade-off there. And certainly what I've seen and watching kind of online groups with veterans is I don't believe that they provide the same support, the same intimacy, and the same skills that you get from face-to-face meetings. And I think that will be the challenge. And I'm nervous if we move to a completely electronic world, we will lose what it is that makes us as good, in the same way that all the kind of electronic packages for psychological treatments, they work fine if you have a spider phobia, but they don't work fine if you have anything more complicated than that. And most of the people we see are more complicated. If it was simply a matter of following a computer program, you wouldn't need us. You wouldn't need a mental health system at all.
I completely agree, actually, and that's not sort of me buttering you up. But
I
think
that
there is a problem with that sort of what's lost through technology as well as what's gained. And we've actually jumped already to question three. So because I was going to ask you specifically if there were technological innovations that you saw as potentially positive. And I think that caveat around online consultations, are there any that you think, you're a great tweeter, and I'm wondering if, I mean, that's not as much part of the sustainability agenda, but thinking about any sort of technological innovation that you see could be helpful, or is that a bit of a red
Well, I'm the last person to talk on technological innovation. I think the bicycle is a technological innovation, at least it is for me, in that sense. But I'm just kind of thinking also what Daniel was saying as well, and warming to the theme of kind of also unintended consequences. I mean, we all work at SLAM, and as you know, we have this new, it's not new, actually, doing for ages, haven't we, of sending text messages to reduce DNA, the do not attends, which is actually very successful. And it's very hard to remember the last time I had a DNA. But there is, of course, the unintended consequences. All of us like a few DNAs in our life, because, I mean, we do. We genuinely do. When you get a DNA, it's not often that your immediate reaction is, oh, my God, the patient hasn't turned up. This is a disaster. Your first reaction is, thank God, I've got 45 minutes off to catch up with A, B, C, and D. If you didn't have a few of these breaks in your life, it would actually add to the burden and pressure that we all feel. And I actually mean that quite seriously, actually, that we can eliminate what you might call waste. But waste is also time for ourselves, time to do all the other things that we have to do that we're not allowed to do according to our bloody job plans and all that kind of stuff. So, again, I'm slightly cautious about that. The most things have unintended consequences, I've discovered, and that would be another one. I like a few DNAs.
I had a DNA yesterday and it meant... Sorry?
I'm assuming you're doing it anyway. I've long since given up any concept of privacy in this world, I tell you.
Two DNAs yesterday, managed to get my mandatory training done on safer prescribing.
So it's a shame you didn't do something useful.
Yeah, I know.
Because that's another. That's the one you ask about reducing waste. What would I like to do if I became king? I would abolish all mandatory training. And I would do that because if it's mandatory, then probably it's no good, because in education, the whole point about education is about choice, and we use choice to drive up standards in education. If you have to go to something, then there's no reason at all to make it any good, because you have to go anyway. And what drives up in the teaching, I've given up as well on that bit, but in the courses that we run, what increases standards and gets students coming in is the course is good. And if they stop coming, we know the course is bad, and we have to change it. And I have a real aversion to mandate. I've been saying this for ages. I think most of it's useless, and it's hugely expensive in time, etc. And that's how I'd start if I became the kind of Green King. That's a beer, actually, isn't it, Green King?
Green King, yeah. It is.
Possibly the wrong word.
But I'm quite excited about this. I'm going to abandon the questions for a second.
Ah, good.
Because
let's see how we do without them completely.
Yeah, we throw them away. That's quite a bold statement, and I like it, that mandatory training is potentially something that you have a problem with as ineffective, but then you take the sustainability agenda, all of the research and thinking and the necessary changes that need to happen around sustainability, and there's different ways of approaching sustainability, and one is to bring to bear that sustainability thinking onto something like mandatory training, and go, is this sustainable? And it sounds as though on all three levels of the triple bottom line, it doesn't sound so you agree with it.
So unfortunately, it is sustainable.
There's a workshop there.
It's been sustained. So by definition, it's sustainable. What you mean, is it useful? And is it value for money? And is it cost effective? And are there better things that we could be doing? And are there better ways that we could be doing the things we're supposed to do? I mean, the only one exception I would make would probably be recess. I probably would possibly make an exception for that. But that would be about it.
So I think maybe we leave that there, but I'm very curious if other people have thoughts around mandatory training and whether that could even be something to think about over the day as a bringing that sustainability agenda to it, because it's a huge resource on my time speaking as a changing trusts and things like that. We may come back to that, but I'll sort of plough on with the questions. we'll do the carbon footprint question here.
Good.
So you all saw earlier the slide that Daniel showed around the need for an 80% reduction in 3 decades, and I've got this is really the only reason I need this, is to say that 16% is medication in terms of the carbon footprint from mental health services, 12% on equipment, 17% on travel, and 24% on heat and light, which is a real bugbear of mine. But I wondered if you had any thoughts on getting that 80% reduction, given those are the main things of heating and lighting, travel, equipment.
I'm quite in favour of heating and lighting, to be honest.
Yeah.
Wouldn't reduce that. No, I haven't really. I mean, the only thing I can say is I do cycle. That's my bike there. I was actually thinking of cycling into this conference, but I got the timing wrong. So just to make the point. But I think that's the only thing I do that is consciously based around that agenda. How many people cycled here today? I don't think any of you did, because there's no bikes outside the college. Oh, a few of you did. Okay. All right. But that's not very good.
There's not a great cycle lockup at the college.
No, it's around the back. It's very good. It's around the back.
There's not. Okay. I had struggled to get in there a few weeks ago.
Oh,
that's just me.
All right. We'll sort it. Okay. Vanessa's nodding. No, she isn't, actually. We'll sort it. You are. She is. Yeah. You have to be extremely fit to put the ones at the front. You have to be you have to lift up.
You have to
be a kind of bodybuilder in order to use those. But there are better ones at the back. I've completely now riffed away. Question. What was it?
Travel is one, which is, I suppose, getting to and from work for all the people. There's also huge conferences and summits where people are brought in from all over the world. And there's lots of, I think, ways of incentivizing perhaps rail travel over air travel and trying to encourage. There's lots of local innovations, I think, around travel. I certainly know the hospitals as a cyclist who doesn't have a car, I can tell you very quickly the hospitals I've worked in, the ones that support cycling, the ones that don't. So I think there's ways of supporting cyclists.
But we've got a long way to go, because if you look at patient satisfaction surveys on their care, number one is car parking. It's nothing to, again, another of these myths that we've been sold is satisfaction studies about things that are important, like the quality of the care you get. That actually, the number one thing is always car parking. I only learned that yesterday, actually, at the Tory party conference, of all places. Well, you couldn't drive, thank God. But it's car parking. You've got a long way to go.
I'm loath to increase or push for an increase in car parking spaces.
But it would increase our patient satisfaction, which is apparently what we all want. So
I want to try and get them all on bicycles, but maybe that's my idealistic thinking. So that was a thought around explicitly carbon footprint and addressing that. There's also, I think, a particular sort of agenda of mine is just waste around buildings. And I suppose when I said heating and lighting is heating and lighting buildings when it's not necessary. And I think that's something that I see quite a bit of, but I just wanted to sort of bring it up. I don't think there is an immediate, easy solution.
No, there's
that,
was that thing they do at Barts? Was it TLC, something, turn lights off, turn lights, something, and close doors? It was quite clever. I only remember because it's a clever, well, I don't remember because I've got the acronym wrong. But I can't remember. It's
turn off, lights out, close doors.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, there we are, that's quite good.
And those are relatively simple innovations that I think if you spread that culture of...
You know, switching back to my training in epidemiology, it's small changes by lots of people that always have much more differences to population health than a large change by a small number of people. So it's a small, it's a kind of small change that actually does have impact on basic epidemiological principles.
So, yeah, something we could push, I hope. Thinking about the social sustainability side, and this is something that... Daniel and I have spoken about and interested in. And one of the reasons he asked me to come here is that I took a couple of years away from psychiatry and studied a sort of form of collaborative theatre making. So you devise pieces of theatre together with people from all over the world, actually, which now I think about it, they all had to fly there, so that wasn't so good. But it really reinforced...
Should we move swiftly on then?
Yeah, we'll step over that. I didn't fly. It was in London. I didn't fly anywhere, but they did. It reinforced my belief in the need for strong social networks, for connections between people, and also the value of sort of these arts interventions, which are less sort of the medication heavy aspect of their carbon footprint and the social network. I also just wanted to mention in 1 minute, I don't know if you've heard of Converge, which I don't know if anyone else has, at York University, St John's York University. I'm only mentioning this because last night I was at a little think tank around arts in health meeting, and Converge is something that was initiated at York University, and it was where they used university facilities within the arts faculty, and they took people who had significant mental health difficulties and brought them into that faculty and simply taught them. It wasn't explicitly about saying, it was called Education for Recovery. It used existing sort of infrastructure and resources in terms of the teachers. Some undergraduates also taught, and gave people with significant mental health problems an atmosphere within which they could simply engage in an activity related, well, it was education. It was very, what was great about it was very sort of unpatronizing. It was just, you are simply part of this and you will gain perhaps a qualification in time, but more contact, connection, sort of feeling better about oneself. And it sounded inspiring to me, and I shall be looking into it further. But that's an anecdote, but it just seemed very elegant in taking what was already existing, bringing different spaces together, generating social networks. That's, yeah, I mean, do you have any other examples of that kind of social sustainability?
Sure. I mean, first of all, let's not use the word inspiring, shall we? It's one of my hate words.
Okay.
I mean, I'm actually more impressed when people say mildly exciting.
Okay.
Because I think that's actually whelmed. I know.
Not even overwhelmed.
If you count the number of people who are inspired in one sentence, it's something amazing. Okay. Anyway, but mildly exciting. Yes, I mean, well, closer to home where we work, Wojciech, the unusual name, and Louise Murphy, they have the photography club, don't they? It's got a name as well. It's not called, that's what it is. And it's just straightforward. Obviously, a lot of the people in the club are users of our patients, of our services, but it isn't about that. It's about photography. And they do exhibitions around the Maudsley, and they did an exhibition at the Royal College, I'm pretty sure, at least one of the meetings they did. Yeah, I mean, all of those things, you know, they're clearly good. And I don't know if anyone even reads him anymore, but do you remember Robert Putnam, the American sociologist? I think he's still alive, actually, isn't he? And he wrote that book, Bowling for America, or it's why Americans don't bowl. I think that's the title. And it's about the decline of social capital across America, that they don't go to bowling clubs anymore. Although it's been pretty strongly refuted. Yeah, they don't, but they do lots of other things instead. And I think that's probably true of our lives as well. I don't belong to the Susan Greenfield view that the rise of the internet, etc., means that no one actually talks to each other anymore, and there's been a decrease in communication and capital. Because I don't actually see that at all. I don't see that in my own children. I'm just incredibly jealous that they don't spend all the time that I did as a student going to parties that weren't happening, because you're in the wrong place and everyone had moved on and you could never bloody find them, and you ended up incredibly... You all remember that, students, how miserable you used to work, and they say, oh, they've gone. Where have they gone to? I think they went to the Red Lion. You go to the Red Lion, they're not there.
No, it's just me.
Thank you. You're probably right. But do you remember all the time you used to waste not going, not having fun and not going to parties and not meeting people? And as far as I can tell my children, they don't seem to have that problem at all. And you only need to go to, you know, bars and restaurants around London to see there's been no change. And in fact, if anything, it's much better. So I'm not a pessimist on that particular view. But clearly, the importance of social capital in promoting mental health is about the single most important thing there is. I mean, I've given up now in kind of studies on PTSD, which I do quite a bit of, which always comes back to the biggest protective factor always remains social cohesion. And working with the military as I do, that's one lesson they don't need to learn. They're actually well ahead of us on that one. And they know that's much more important than any psychologist, any psychiatrist, etc., is units of strong social cohesion.
I remember you talking about that.
I know, I often do.
Yeah, no, and it was not inspiring, but
mildly interesting. Thank you. Let's all be mildly interesting.
Yeah, it was thought provoking. Is that?
No, you can say that.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll stick with thought.
Don't say passionate. No passion.
Okay, fine. Okay. There is zero passion or inspiration in the room, but there's a lot of thoughts being provoked.
I want to have a passionate free day, okay?
Okay.
No inspiration,
I'm going to struggle with that, but but I wonder whether there's... If we all in the room talk about that need for greater social capital and networks, are there any concrete ways of making that... I mean, I'm thinking as a registrar in psychiatry, and obviously as core trainees and other people, and the wider network of mental health professionals, are there ways of... enabling people to have that. I have a research and special interest time. Yeah. I have an ARCP. There's things where the college could intervene and say, well, hey, in your annual appraisal, where have you engaged with a network of social capital? Are there ways in to sort of say, take it from the talking level that we all know it's, sorry, I don't know if you can catch that, if it's all positive and helpful, and going, can you as doctors actually be involved in this more?
Well, of course you can. I mean, you know, just within this particular college, you can join the trainees committee. All of these committees, most of the good that they probably do is actually in acquiring the bonds that you need to sustain a professional life. It just so happens, by coincidence, this Sunday, it's the 30th anniversary of the day I started at the Maudsley, and all our group, bar one, are meeting again. And that social capital that we had, I mean, they're a weird bunch, I mean, like people like Declan Murphy, Mike Farrell and all that lot, but we're all getting together from Australia, America, Britain, and that's the group I met on my first day at the Maudsley, and I'm still friends with all of them. And that's helped me much more than all this talk about, oh, you need a mentor, all that kind of stuff. I think you need mates, you need friends, and you need people in the same, you know, job who know what you're doing and can support you. And when times have been difficult, that's been far more valuable than anything else. The danger we have as professionals is when we create ersatz social capital. And, you know, this takes me back to the story of, you know, debriefing and also some of the failures of counselling that we know have happened, is where, you know, you are actually actively preventing people from making the genuine social networks that they need to cope with adversity, and sometimes replacing them with false social networks. And again, that's the kind of unintended consequences of some of the things that we do. So, as I say, this is why I like things like the photography club and the art club that you mentioned. Those are much more natural endeavors, whereas the false creation of social networks and capital actually probably does more harm than good.
Yes, I mean, I suppose they're brittle, they're not really embedded, and they're easily shorn away under
they
stress.
And they're also they're also unequal, and they're also about the professionalisation of normal emotion, as opposed to what we do, which is dealing with abnormal feelings, emotions and thoughts. But the professionalisation of normal emotions has been something that's concerned me most of my career.
I feel like I'd agree.
But that's good. You're doing well.
I'm thinking more to push you on the sort of, if we say that we can just take away all that mandatory training, I'm now freed up with time. How do we, I suppose what I'm looking at is trying to get health professionals to engage more with that, the existing social structures, trying to strengthen and understand them without being sort of cack-handedly involved. Is there space for saying that we ought to be doing that, as both doctors?
I mean, I clearly do think that we should be doing that. And
how do we make
a trend,
it happen?
Oh, I don't know how you do that. But a trend that does worry me in psychiatry is the alienation of many psychiatrists, particularly the kind of new junior consultants, from getting more engaged in their own job, in the sense in the trusts that they work or in the wider health environment. And I do meet consultants who say, well, I just want to do my job. And by which they say, I just want to see patients. I don't quite believe that, actually. But it's also worrying that it means they're not prepared to take on wider roles, which A, will sustain you on the longer term in a career, and B, do a huge amount of good. And I hear that a lot from chief execs who keep saying, what's wrong with the consultants these days? They don't seem to want to get involved. And that worries me. Now, I don't know what the answer to that is. I suspect it's to do with morale, and I suspect it's a two-way process, but it's a worrying trend.
And that's involved in the NHS Trust as well as
in the local
community. And
and even doing things that we sometimes make fun of, but actually keep the world churning, like management and and so on. These are really important. I would like to hope they also do teaching and research, which are very important. They're both important for their own sake, but I also think they're important for a kind of a healthy working life. That and I'm nervous about people saying, I just want to do clinical work. I don't think you can sustain that over a 30-year career. You have to do other things as well.
Which is an element of sustainability, is having a workforce who have some degree of, because I'm just increasingly interested in resilience, and I think that's where some of this social network and sustainability comes in. And having a workforce who have a diverse role and they're involved in different things, I think will lead to more resilience. We've got 5 more minutes, so just to sort of recap, we've had a look at that sort of the carbon footprint and ways of addressing that in terms of travel and medication, things that Daniel mentioned. We've some scepticism around technology and some enthusiasm, and then a discussion around social capital. I've got a couple of concluding questions which are largely around going forward and the future, which is similar to where we started. Okay. But I did want to honour that promise and say that we have the president here, and if anyone else had a question for the last few minutes, then you are welcome. Otherwise, we're going to explore the sort of the future and where we go next in the last few minutes. So if anyone does have a direct question, you're welcome.
Given that the college is going to continue to exist and the profession is going to continue to exist, which I think are questions, what role do we have as professionals, as doctors, in the wider debate, which is why I came, of environment and society and the globe as a whole? Do doctors have a role in actually advocating against the climate change deniers and encouraging our community as a whole to recognise that we're on the precipice of disaster? Take the UN summit and the mobilisation that nobody noticed that happened a week ago. But we actually have to do something, and people like Simon, I hope, would be very strong advocates in saying we all have to change, and yes, that will be good for our mental health, but actually we won't survive if we don't. I raise the example, in which I'm old enough to have been involved, of the role the BMA and the medical profession took in the anti-nuclear debate in the 80s, and it was a very powerful role, and producing a wide-ranging report on the health effects of nuclear weapons. Couldn't we do something similar on the health effects of climate change, that we take an advocacy role in the wider community and try and change factors as a whole? Simon?
Well, I certainly think doctors do that. I mean, I heard mention of Richard Horton's leadership role here, which has been, I mean, I've heard him talk several times on this, and it's incredibly compelling. And it's also had an influence in our overseas aid policies. I mean, actually, medicine plays an increasingly important role in the work of DFID, partly due to the sustained attention given by The Lancet and the work that they've done on climate change. All of that, I think, is, as you say, fairly self-evident, but almost certainly needs more. And I think you probably also are slightly sceptical of what role psychiatry would play in this. You spent most of your life in Kosovo and Somalia and most of the world's nasty spots. And I know you yourself are slightly sceptical about parachuting in psychiatrists into cultures they don't understand, languages they don't speak, who end up saying everyone's very unhappy, which is really rather obvious. And I share that too. And I remember, again, going back now, reading a paper on the Armenian earthquake, and they did a study using some diagnostic instrument, and they concluded that 97% of all the children in Yerevan, I think it was, had PTSD, which has to, you know, pretty high up on the kind of meaningless pieces of psychiatric research. I'd be rather concerned that we don't do that, and because, you know, in war-torn areas, we know people need security, food, education, and all those things. I'm not sure they need, at that point, psychiatrists, unless they have or existing psychiatric disorders, where they certainly do, and they're completely neglected and usually die quickly and horribly. It would be interesting. Yes, I think the psychiatry of denial is an interesting area.
I'm going to go Paxman in the last 10 seconds and take your question and just say, what it felt like you were asking, correct me if I'm wrong, was that we can come together as a wider body of doctors to talk about climate change as an issue that's going to affect the UK and soon.
Sure.
And that we should be doing that with a louder and more coherent voice as a matter of urgency and akin to anti-nuclear. What do you think about
that? Well, yes, and many doctors do. I mean, Charlie Thompson and Dave Pension come to mind, other than mates of mine at medical school. I think that's right. I'm just, all slightly cautious about what psychiatry, we're doctors, and as doctors we should, and as citizens we should. I am just slightly cautious to what psychiatrists would say that would be helpful in the kind of climate change debate, other than what doctors would say as doctors.
Well, we've taken a lead with...
Otherwise we can sound sometimes very banal. We can sound saying that if Britain got washed away in a flood, everybody would be upset. You know, that's a kind of banal comment that I would hope we wouldn't make. And I'd like it to be something a little bit more profound than that.
I suppose I was envisaging, as we've taken a lead on sustainability with Daniel's post and this summit, that we push towards a coalition of Royal Colleges and a larger statement and a larger voice where we are one of many who are all talking about the need for a sort of coherent and urgent addressing of this issue. But I think that's not a question, and I'm verging on getting passionate, so we're going to stop
it's 11 minutes
past 11.
Okay.
But I suppose is that what you were getting at? And thank you very much for the question. Thank you, Daniel, for allowing me to break it open unexpectedly. And thank you so much for coming, for being so honest and helpful and great company.
Okay, cheers. Thanks very much. Cheers.